I'm Jen Sheridan. I am the curator of amphibians and reptiles here at the Carnegie Museum of Natural History. I'm an ecologist. Most of my research focuses on ecological responses to climate change and responses to habitat and land use change. And the majority of my research takes place in Malaysian Borneo. And this spring and summer, I also start some work out at Powder Mill, our research station. Reptiles are what we call ectotherms, and that means that their metabolism is dictated by their environment. It correlates directly with temperature. A lot of people think this means that they're cold-blooded, but actually, because their metabolism directly correlates with temperature, they can actually be quite warm depending on the environment in which they live. They also have a shelled egg, and this is one thing that separates reptiles from amphibians, is this shell that evolved to protect the egg. So amphibian eggs are gelatinous, they have to be laid in water or in very moist environments, but because the reptiles evolved that shell around their egg, that helps to protect that egg, and they were therefore able to exploit many more habitats than the amphibians were. One of my favorite adaptations of reptiles is actually sort of specific to South and Southeast Asia, and that is the ability to glide or fly. And there's a couple of groups that do this very well. One is the flying lizards, or Draco, and one is the flying snakes, or Chrysopelea. So Draco is a genus name. That genus occurs in Southeast Asia, as well as other parts of Asia. And the Draco have these sort of wings on the sides of their body. They have long extended ribs that extend out and extend those skin flaps, and they're able to glide from tree to tree. The other nice thing about that is that those wings are different colors depending on the species. So sometimes those wings are green or brown. They can be bright yellow or bright red, and it's really neat to see that variation across species. The Chrysopelea, or the snakes, they don't have these wings per se, but what they do is they flatten their bodies dorsoventrally, so top to bottom, and then they sort of undulate through the air as they're gliding. So they'll get to the edge of a branch and they sort of launch themselves through the air. Reptiles serve as both consumers and prey. So lots of birds eat reptiles, lots of mammals eat reptiles, and then reptiles themselves take a wide array of organisms as their own prey. So small-bodied reptiles will often eat invertebrates, but there's also cool specialist feeders. So for example, there's a snake called Aplopeltura boa that exists in Borneo, and that's specialized to feed on snails. It has a very square head. It extends its lower jaw and pulls that snail meat out of that shell. One of the world's most threatened vertebrate groups is actually a reptile group, and that is the turtles. So more than 40% of turtle species are actually threatened with extinction. And these threats come largely from humans. So a lot of turtles have experienced habitat losses, but in addition, turtles are very popular in the pet trade and also as food. And the pet trade and that food trade really have driven a lot of turtles to the brink of extinction. Additionally, humans have changed the climate of the Earth, and the changes that we've seen in temperature and the changes in rainfall pattern have been shown to negatively impact reptiles broadly. So we talked about the fact that reptiles are ectotherms, their metabolism is directly tied to the temperature of their environment, and so that means that their behavior then has been altered by these increased temperatures. Additionally, because we're seeing longer droughts and more unpredictable rainfall patterns, it makes it harder for reptiles to, in some environments, to find the water that they need.